I'm really happy when pastor's wife said that God, women are very special to God. I also feel the same, and I always used to say, heaven will be overcrowded with women. Less of, because one of my friends, you know, she said, women will definitely go to heaven because they have already had hell here. So I too believe in that. So that's it. So we'll go to the message. Please turn your Bibles to the book of Proverbs. You know, there are a lot of women in the book of Proverbs. Like a fashion parade, you know, you can see women walking across your face in the book of Proverbs. Can you name some of the women that you know in the book of Proverbs?
Wise woman.
Wise woman, yes.
Virtuous
woman, yes.
Harlot.
Harlot, yes. That's all.
God-fearing.
Virtuous, yes. Eh? One day I counted almost 18-20 women. So make it an exercise. If you go through the book of Proverbs, you find lot of women, and very interesting study can be taken from that. So even though we may not be able to cover all those women, I have chosen a few women which can be of, we can study today. If you keep your book, Bible to the book of Proverbs, in the first chapter itself, we read about a woman. That is in verses, chapter 1, verse 8 and 9, we read about the law-giving mother. It's very interesting. You know, she's not just a wobbly duck like, you know, she's a very powerful person, the lawgiver. Whom do you say lawgiver in the government? She's in a very powerful position. Read from verses 8 and 9. My son, hear the instruction of your father and do not forsake the law of your mother. The law of the mother, for they will be graceful ornament on your head and chains about your neck. Hope you have all brought your Bibles. Have you given this necklace to your children? The mother is to present a necklace. See, it is like a graceful ornament on your head and chains about your neck. So this is the children's ornament. What is that? The law of the mother. Come to Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 20. Proverbs chapter 6 from verse 20, again we see a repetition of the same. My son, keep your father's command and do not forsake the law of your mother. See, the father gives the commandment and goes for work. Who is there at home to implement all that? It is the mother who gives the law. And it says, bind them continually upon your heart. Tie them around your neck. This is the instruction for the children. When you roam, they will lead you. You know, these days, children roam. I get lot of complaints from children and also from mothers. Children say, my parents don't allow me to roam around till 1 o'clock in the night. And parents say, our children come at 1 o'clock in the night, 2 o'clock, what shall we do? So, it says, when they roam, they will lead you. What? The mother's law will lead them. When you sleep, they will keep you. When your children sleep, what law you have given them, these laws will keep them. When they awake, they will speak with you. See, when children are awake, it says they will speak. You know, these days, when our children go into the world, so many people speak. The teacher says something, the teacher says you came from monkey. Mommy says you, God created you. Whom to believe? The Bible says when your children awake, your law is going to speak to your children. Some of you are unmarried, I know that. But you are going to get married, you are going to get babies, you are going to bring up children. So you need to know all these things. Because, you know, these days, young girls, when they get married, they don't even think that they can be housewives. They think we have to find a job, we have to earn, we have to get a fat salary, we have to apply here, there, that's... It's good, but what I want to tell young girls is, you also should pray, Lord, do you want me to be a housewife? That is number one priority in your life. Don't have children, neglect them and send them to hell. It's the worst kind of crime. Children are given to you by God so that you can give them back to God. You can't neglect your children and throw them away just like that. So these laws that you implement at home, they will speak to your children and guide you, guide them. I know, because, you know, I used to tell my daughter so many things. And she used to say, oh, mama, what mommy? I used to feel so bad and so sorry. But you know, when she left us, when she went to college, you know what she used to write to me? Mommy, see mommy, these girls are like this. These girls are like, I can't stand it, mommy. You have to be like this. I do like this. I was so happy, you know. When she was at home, she never realized it. But when she left home and she left her parents, when she was independent, the what we taught her started speaking to her. See, the law-giving mother is a very strong personality. These days, women are called as a weaker sex. I don't believe that. We women are a very strong sex. They are the lawgivers at home. That is why I say, don't leave your home, don't neglect your home, and don't be a lawgiver for the government. God has called you for something else. Many women don't understand that. First, I would like to tell you how you can bring up your children. It's very, very important. There are four areas where your children grow. Like, how did Jesus grow? Jesus grew in wisdom, in stature, in favor with God and favor with men. So our children need to become very wise. We have to teach them all those things. And stature, we have to feed them the good things. You know, working mothers, they simply open two packages, microwave them and feed the children. Because, you know, you buy greens, you clean them, cut them, it takes a lot of time. But you must know what is good for your children. So, McDonald's, yes, what is that? Some Kentucky. Okay, these things are all good, but only occasionally. It's now the change is there, you know. Because it is easy, we tend to buy sandwiches and soft drinks and you load your fridges with these things. And then your children are not at all properly fed. They must feed them. You don't think I am not teaching you Bible. It is Bible. You came here to hear something about prayer and Bible reading and this. No, I want to speak specifically to women where these areas are neglected. So take care of your children's food. Buy lot of vegetables, greens, fruits at home. Load your fridge with these things. So that children learn to eat these things occasionally for a picnic when you go out. Let them eat a burger. Let them eat a Kentucky chicken. That's okay. Let them have a cola, Coca-Cola. Not regularly at home. That will be good for their health. And then favor with God. You must give them a religious training. Favor with men. Teach them to say thank you, please, hello, welcome, good morning, will you please sit down. All these social niceties, you know, you must teach your children. Only if you are at home, you can do all these things. It goes without saying. Okay, when it comes to the religious training, come to Proverbs 31, verse 26. Last chapter, the proverbial woman whom we refer to very frequently. Proverbs 31 and verse 26. She opens her mouth with wisdom and on her tongue is the law of kindness. She is the woman who kindly teaches her children. Mothers are teachers. We go to church, okay? We bring our children to church. We send them to Sunday class. That is all now. That is not everything. The first teacher, the primary teacher for the children is the mother. So home teaching is very, very important. Buy a children's Bible for your children with all the pictures. You know, I think I started when my daughter was maybe 2.5 years, 3 years. By the time she was 5 years, she finished the Bible. When I sent to Sunday class, you know, the teachers used to complain, please don't send her to Sunday class. When we start the story, she finishes it. And then they will say, my daughter, your daughter is asking for unbiblical stories. Because you know all the Bible stories she knew. Teacher, please tell us some unbiblical story. Because she was a child in her own language. So what I feel is, children are capable. Don't you teach your children ABCD? When they are 2.5 years, you want your children to learn early and go fast in the world. Why not in the religious world? Why not you teach the Bible? Such young minds, which is so capable of receiving and retaining these things. And you know how Moses was given to the mother back, you know, as a baby. She had only a short time. Then Moses will leave her. So what the mother did, you know, she started teaching so that he became a spiritual leader. So many women threw their babies into the Nile. You know that? How did they do that? They simply threw like that. And the crocodiles in the Nile, they devoured them. But what did Moses' parents do? They didn't do that. They hid the child, first of all. How did they do it? By faith. Hebrews, you read, by faith, the parents of Moses hid him for a certain time. This kind of faith we must have for our children. Don't simply say, oh, Ireland is so bad, our children are not going to, they will go run away, they will, we can't discipline. No, 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 not like that. Even in the Moses' days, killing of babies was there. The crocodiles were devouring. What did the parents do then after the certain time? They made a basket. They didn't simply throw the child like that in the waters. You know, all the neighboring ladies would have laughed at them. You think after 3 months your child is going to survive? Better he dies as a child. Why do you postpone the problem? No, Moses' parents had strong faith. No, my child will not die. He will not be drowned in the Nile. So they made a basket. They put a tarpaulin, whatever. They painted tar. They saw against light. Oh, there's a hole there. Light is in. Put some more so that the water will not come in. All protection they gave for the baby. Put him inside. Then said, Lord, our job is over now. It's your job, Lord. So they put him in the night. What happened? God answered their faith. Isn't it? The Lord sent some. This is what you should do for your baby. Simply neglecting your babies, children, and simply if you pray, Lord, keep our babies, or God is not going to keep our babies. You have to do your part. Then put them in the Nile. The world is a Nile full of crocodiles, but nothing can harm a child. God will send the queen to save that child, and he will become a spiritual leader. All our children can become spiritual leaders, can't they? Are they going to serve? If you believe in it, say amen.
Amen.
Yes, our children are given by God, and we are going to give our children back to God to serve him. We are not going to lose our children to Satan. Don't believe that. It's the lie of the devil. So give the religious teaching. Some people used to tell me, you know, you are dumping religion down your daughter's throat. Don't do that. She will hate religion. I didn't believe that, because the Bible says you talk about it when you walk, you talk about it when you sit, you talk about it when you lie down, write it on the wall, put it on that. Is it not overload of religion? The Bible expects us to do that. God expects us to load our children with religion, because when they go into the world is going to load them with all the dirty things. Before that, you prepare your child, and when the child goes outside into the world, the Lord can keep our children. That is religious training. Secondly, discipline. Discipline is very, very important. You know, so many believers are indisciplined. Do you know that? Discipling means coming under some kind of discipline. That is the tough side of love. You know, love has got two sides. One is the gentle, soft side, and the other is the tough side. Your children need to eat proper food. Sometimes, you know, they will push away the spinach. No, I don't want. I want only chicken. Nothing doing. Unless you eat, you cannot get down from your chair. Put the law there. That is disciplining your child. Teaching the child to properly eat, to properly dress. My grandchild is now, you know, daytime she is with me. By the time she learned to walk, 1 year, I made her take the pamper and throw it in the dustbin. She still does it. She is now 3. Takes a pamper, takes it right there, puts it there, and takes her panties and puts it for washing. Now she is doing it. Because my daughter used to get lot of beatings. Here you can't do. You can't beat your children. So unless you discipline. You discipline them today, tomorrow they will be good wives. You know, many husbands are complaining. My husband used to complain. What, you are throwing your things everywhere? Because I was never trained, to tell you very honestly, we were never trained like, we will simply take a clothes, put it some corner, the servant will do all those things. Then next day it will be washed, ironed and kept ready for you. So I never learned these things. So my husband had a real tough time with me. And my mother-in-law, she couldn't stand me. Then, you know, it was another world for me. But now I trained my daughter to do things properly. Don't throw the clothes. Put it here. Put it here. And then, you know what she will do? She won't put out the bathroom light. She will go to school. After she had gone only, I'll realize light is on. I'll call, come here, Evangeline, come, come. She'll come running thinking I've got something for her. And I'll tell her, put out the bathroom light. Mommy, you called me just for that? Yes, just for that. This I did not 1 year, 2 years, till she was 16, I did it. Then she went to college. And she said, Mommy, these girls are not putting off the light, Mommy. I have to go and switch it off. See, when we train them, at home they dislike it. But once they go out, it comes. Same, she won't wash your clothes. I'll refuse to wash. Her dirty clothes will pile up, pile up, pile up. My husband will come and, please, she has come on holidays, please wash her clothes. I said, no, I got a backache, I can't. Then she will put a long face and wash. Today she is such an independent woman, you know, she has got one hand paralyzed. Many of you may not know that. She has a birth injury, one hand paralyzed. But still, I never showed her kindness for that. I treated her like a normal person. With one hand, she does all that. She cooks, she cleans, she washes, she takes care of her child. I really thank God, you know, because I used to get confused. Like, should I be so strict with my child? But now today I know, this, it pays, really it pays. Come to Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 24. Proverbs 13. And verse 24, here of course in Ireland you can't practice it, but this is what the Bible says. Bible is very different. He who spares his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him promptly. Disciplines. Maybe you can leave out half the verse because you can't use a rod here. The next half says, he who loves him disciplines him. If you can't be, what you know, you can deprive your child of something. Maybe you can pack up the TV and put it up. Unless you do it, no TV. Switch off the TV. Something, some privilege she or he has to lose, and they will come round. Child, come to chapter 29, Proverbs chapter 29 and verse 15. See, these days children are not brought up. They grow up. Children must be brought up. The rod and rebuke give wisdom. It's not just the rod. Don't tell me we can't use a rod. The rod and rebuke. You have to rebuke your children. You have to be very strong with your children. But a child left to himself brings shame to the mother, not the father. Anybody will know, you see, indisciplined child, whose child is? Mary's child, angel's child. They'll say only both, only the mother, not the father. Shame to the mother, no? That is why, mothers, you should discipline your children. And come to chapter 23, Proverbs chapter 23, verses 13 and 14. Do not withhold correction from a child, for if you beat him with a rod, he will not die. You shall beat him with a rod and deliver his soul from hell. If you are strict with your children, if you are hard-hearted and strong, and then he will go to heaven. You want your children to go to hell or heaven? Then you must dare to discipline, as the book says, dare to discipline. You have to. You know, children will try to push you. They will say, no, I will not do it. You know what my granddaughter says? I will tell her, no ma, Jesus doesn't like this. Jesus like this. Jesus likes this. Mama, that is how our children, you know, that is very normal and natural. They will push us. But early you must teach them who is the master at home. Who is the ruler at home. Don't allow your children to have their own way. Teach them to accept no. You know, sometimes I've seen mothers, the child will scream and throw a temper tantrum to get one ice cream. Mothers will say, no, no ice cream today. Child screams more and more. No, she says, I told you no. Child screams more. And then she says, okay, go to hell. Come on, buy one ice cream. Now the child has learned one valuable lesson. What? If you scream more, you can get things done. That is where many of us make a mistake. You say, nothing doing, you scream, I don't care. No ice cream, no ice cream. Then the child will scream, throw temper tantrum. You don't beat the child for that. Just leave him alone. He'll cool down. Then he'll quieten down. Now he knows who is the boss at home. When mommy says no, it means no. You must teach that principle. It will be a lifelong lesson for your child. So, all these small things, you know, especially children coming home on time, going to wild parties, all these things. So, but sometimes, you know, you have to be easy on them also. You should not be cruel with your children. See, love has two sides. One is the tough side, the other is the soft side. Children are a gift from God. The Bible says in the last days men shall be lovers of their own selves. That natural love will be lacking in 1 Timothy 3rd chapter. You will read that. How people will be in the... Sometimes, you know, mothers are very cruel to their children. They beat, you know, children black and blue like they beat oxen. No, in India, here you don't find oxen, I don't know. Here all India, all our streets are full of oxen and people beat the oxen. Like that they beat the children. It's very cruel. Don't beat your children like that. Don't lock them up in dark rooms. It's all very bad. Love your children. When it starts as the baby is born, you breastfeed your children. Nowadays this bottle has become a fashion. All these artificial feeds. It's not only good for health, it's also healthy for the emotional development of the child. You know, the bonding between mother and baby, it comes when you feed your baby and emotionally you are attached. And the baby doesn't get diarrhea, sickness, it's got lot of antibodies. So, it's not a fashion to not breastfeed your child. Please, the Bible says how women breastfed their children. You know, Anna says, no, I'm not coming to the temple, I'm feeding my child. See how women gave importance to feeding their children. So, there is no shame in it. What is that? Love is the basic thing a woman must have. Come to Titus chapter 2 and verse 4. See there what women are advised. Titus 2 and verse 4. That they admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children. It says older women must teach the younger women to love the children. That means this love sometimes doesn't come automatically. You know, it has to be taught. Older women must teach the younger women to love the children. So we have to teach them, Illama, don't beat your child like that. Love the child, hug the child, kiss the child, play with the child. Nowadays, you know, it's very hard to see parents playing with their children. I feel so sad about it. You know, when my daughter was small, even I used to feel guilty, to be very honest. I used to think, no, I am a missionary. How can I cycle with my child? What will people think? Then I decided, what is there? Nothing wrong. So I and my daughter, you know, used to go lot of cycling because her father was usually away on camps. So I was her companion, used to cycle a lot. When the rain comes, we'll run out and play in the puddles. And we'll make paper boats. And I don't see these things these days. How sad. Mothers, you know, you must play with your children. That is how the child understands love. It is not buying ice cream and giving, no, unhealthy ways of loving your child. buying toys, giving them money. Instead, you spend time with your children. Tell them stories. Night time, you know, with the picture Bible, you spend time with your child. And then, you know, why this thing is happening is because women are working. They don't have time. Only the maid plays with the children. Now here you don't even have a maid. All the maid has is a TV. TV in the morning, TV in the afternoon, TV in the evening, TV in the evening. Praise the Lord, we have TV. Is that the way we teach our children? Whatever the TV language they listen, that's all they can speak. Whatever TV teaches them, that's all. They see a lot of violence, crime, murder. Don't blame your children tomorrow. Spend time with your child. Mothers, don't neglect your children. So, see, ambition is good. But don't be over-ambitious. Studying more and more and more. For what? You know, one lady in the middle of the street, she caught me and started crying. What, sister, what? She said, I went to Dubai to earn for my children, to give a good future for my children. Today, my boy is an drug addict, my daughter has run away with someone. What will I do with my money? What will you do? Bury it. What for did you earn? If you are losing your children and if you are earning money, what for is that money? God said, even if you gain the whole one and lose your own soul, the souls that God has given, what profit does it have? Women, be wise. So, love your children. Love is not automatic. You have to learn to love your children. Hug them, kiss them. You can't love your children too much. Poor love for them should be more than the discipline. Discipline them, love them. Discipline them, love them. Teach them. So that is how you bring up a lastly, you know, that's what I call as the letting go stage. The stirring up the nest. The eagle builds a nest, has the chicks, and then what does it do? It dismantles the net, the nest. Little by little, it pulls off all the sticks. The chicks will be screaming, oh, mommy, we are going to fall, we are going to fall. Okay, nothing will happen, don't worry. Then suddenly they will fall. What does the eagle do? It goes under the chicks and carries the chicks under. This is exactly you have to do with your children. As your children grow, you know, remove the comforts little by little. I tell my friends, you know, if you don't make breakfast after the child is 10, let them make their own sandwiches. They can. If they are very particular, tell them, I've got a headache, I can't even get up. All of us have it. You don't have to tell a lie. Something we have now, some problem, I'll go back. Oh, I can't get up. If you want, you make. This is their bread is here. The butter is in the fridge. They won't die. No. But you have to be like an eagle watching over the kids. You have to be there because electrical appliances are there. Gas stove is there. Heater is there. Children have to be taught step by step. So then come gradually you come to lunch. You make one rasam. You make one sambar. You can do it, ma. Help me. We'll make sambar today. Little by little, you know. Then letting them go. Teach them. Otherwise, you know, sometimes I've seen some men, they can't buy vegetables. They'll buy such bring jars and come. All full of seeds inside. Don't you know how brinjals, tender brinjals will be? You know, my parents never took me to the market. I didn't know all these things. My husband taught me all these things. He used to tell me, what is this? You don't know how to buy brinjals. Stem must be thick, the sepals must be long. Now how to buy bindis? You break the tail and see. It's crisp, then it's tender. So every small thing, you know, you take your children, you teach them, then you can let them go. Otherwise, there will be headache for the person whom they marry. So, gently you teach them. You have to let them go. When the child is 10 years old, the child will be saying, you know, I don't want this shirt. I will wear only this shirt. Okay? Let him have his way. Because when it comes to matters of drugs and sex and wild parties, you have to hold them strong. You have to say no. So say yes for small things. Don't over-discipline them. Small thing. They have want to have a white haircut. Let them go. Don't have a mirror in your room. Otherwise, so that you will get frightened. Okay. You want to wear this dress? As long as it's a modest dress, okay, go ahead. But when it comes to certain serious matters, then you can hold. Then the child will know, okay, my mother is not a cruel lady. She's gentle, she knows where to. Actually, you know, when you discipline them, when you have rules, laws in your house, children feel very safe. Okay. Then we go to the next woman. We saw about the mother. We see there are next woman in Proverbs chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. It's very sad these days that divorce is becoming more and more rampant. Everybody wants divorce. I don't know why. To deliver you from the immoral woman, from the seductress who flatters with her words, who forsakes the companion of her youth and forgets the covenant of her God. See, if there are 100 reasons to divorce, there are 101 reasons to stay together. Every marriage has got problems. There is no marriage without problem. Do you agree with me? We are not perfect people. We have got a lot of misunderstandings. We fight inside the house. Sometimes, you know, I and my husband fight like cat and dog. Somebody will be knocking at the door, so we'll wipe our face, put some powder and open the door. Come on. They'll say, we have come for counseling. Is that so? Oh, you should not fight like this. And then they, when they go back, we'll continue. That is the truth. That is life. That is reality. But these days, you know, men and women, for all silly reasons, they want divorce. She forsakes the companion of her youth. You married one person, you stick to him. Good or bad, stick to him. He is that person, he is that God-given person. Don't believe the lie of the devil that you cannot live with this person. You know, in States, we have a friend who told us this, that their friends went for counseling. And the counselor said, you both are very incompatible, you can't live together, you better divorce. That is the counseling you get these days. Then this friend was so shocked, they got this couple, started telling, no, don't believe that, you can't live together. You know what, they are living together happily now. How the world can mislead us, you know. Full of satanic ideas. God, in Malachi you read, God hates divorce. You know, some people feel love is the basis of everything. No, love or romance is not the basis of your, it's not the foundation of your marriage. It will vanish away. This romance, you know, this first few weeks you will be running around trees like you see in the some Western people won't understand. They ask the Indians, why when you get when you fall in love you run around trees? That running around trees and sitting in beaches is only for 1 month. After that you start fighting. Husband says your coffee is not good. She says then you, it's like water. My mother used to make better coffee. Then why did you marry me? You are shouting just like your mother. You don't talk about my mother. So picks up. And then they say, we can't live together. Yes, that is not true. You can't live together. You learn to make better coffee and tell your husband to hold his tongue. So gradually you can improve. You can learn a lot, you know. This, the thing the Bible says, she forgets the covenant of her God. See, you make a covenant to live with this person before God. It's not like making a covenant with a man. It's a covenant between you and God. You tell God, Lord, I live with this man till death parts us. Till death do part us. Till then, you hold on. Never, never listen to the lie of the devil So, for a stable marriage, love is not the only thing. It takes commitment. Commitment. Commitment means what Ruth told Naomi. Where you go, I will come. Where you live, I will live. When you die, I will die. Nothing can separate us. She held on to a man. Like that, you hold on to your husband. Hold on to your husband. Never allow the world or people to separate you. Come to 1 Corinthians, that's chapter 7, 1 Corinthians 7, 10 to 16. See, this Solomon had lots of love. He loved 100 women. He told 1,000 women. He told 1,000 women, I love you, I love you. Did his marriage stand? He didn't have the commitment, you know, even though he had so much love, he was a failure. Why? Because that commitment part was missing. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, the first says, now concerning the things of which you wrote to me, it's good for a woman not to touch him. This Corinthians wrote a lot of questions to Paul, and Paul is answering their questions. Reading from verses 10 to 16, now to the married I command, yet not I but the Lord, your wife is not to depart from her husband. And then it says, but even if she does depart, let her remain unmarried. One group from states came to India to lead people in Holy Spirit baptism and all that. Then after the meeting, I wanted her address. I said, Sister, will you please give your address? And she said, shall I give the first address or second address? First fellow, he went away. Second fellow, I was shocked, you know. They're doing ministry and living with more than one person. How sad. It says, don't depart from your husband. Even if you depart, don't remain unmarried or be reconciled to your husband. And a husband is not to divorce his wife. So it's very strong. And it says, but the rest, I not the Lord say, if any brother has a wife who does not believe and she is willing to live with him, let him not divorce her. And a woman who has a husband who does not believe, if he is willing to live with her, let her not divorce him. Even if you are married an unbeliever, even if your husband is an unbeliever, the Bible says, yes, you can make your marriage work. In 1 Peter chapter 3, you know, there are counsels how to live with an unbeliever. And then in verse 14 we read, for the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but now they are good. See, if you don't divorce, still if you live with an unbeliever, if you are a believer, your children are holy, the Bible says. What if you divorce? The Bible does not say, but it goes without saying, your children cannot lead a holy life. They will follow your pattern only. So be careful. Whatever may come, you make a decision that you will not separate from your husband. It is not permanent separation only. Some people, you know, they are separated for the salary sake. Husband working in Dubai, I am working in Ireland. Now my husband is in India, I am in England, Dubai, this, that. People write to me, you know, for my friends. My husband is in India, please pray for him. Or sometimes they will come. I am going to Dubai, please pray and send us. Sister, what about your husband? My husband, we are going to, he will be here because we are building a house. So he will be the accountant, he will be the engineer, and she will be the breadwinner. Don't do that. See, temporary separation also is not good. The Bible very clearly says about that. I will come to it later on. And inside the house, separated. Many houses, I say, they are divorced inside the house. Her husband sleeps in one room, wife sleeps in another room. Or in the heart itself, wife turns to that wall, husband turns to that wall. Fighting. Don't put two beds. If you read Song of Solomon, it says bed, not beds. I don't have time, otherwise I will take you into all these passages and show you. Have one bed, sleep together. Let the children sleep in another room. that will strengthen your love bond. So this separation, you know, it starts in the bed, then in two rooms, then in two houses, then in two countries. Beware. Be careful. God hates divorce. Live together, the Bible says, except for the cause of adultery. That also, repeatedly, if the husband is refusing to repent, God allows divorce, not for any other reason. Thirdly, we come to another woman. Come to Proverbs chapter 5, verses 18 and 19. Here we see a very loving wife. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth. As a loving deer and a graceful doe, let her breast satisfy you at all times and always be enraptured with her love, or intoxicated. It's given so much. It's a commandment given to the husband. It says, live with your wife joyfully. Let her be a graceful doe. Let her breast satisfy you at all times. Be intoxicated with her love. When such a commandment is given to the wife, husband, how should wives be? Sometimes, you know, how this women have a secret feeling that sex is wrong. I don't know how many of you feel that, but I had one patient when I had a clinic at home. That patient was a Christian lady. She used to come. And one day, you know, like friends used to talk, she told me, my husband is an animal. I said, why sister, your husband is a good man. He comes to church regularly and he even sings in the choir. She said, no, he wants sex every day. I said, so what? Why do you call him an animal? And she said, is it not lust? I said, no, it's not lust. Sex is something good which God created, which married people can enjoy without guilt. It's not sin. She said, is it so? Then I told her, no, it's very unwise for you to say that. You should cooperate with your husband. You should be happy your husband is asking you for sex. Then only I thought, you know, there are some people who feel guilty to have sex. Actually, sex is a good thing that God made. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. And verse 1, I think this is one of the questions that this Corinthian church people wrote to Paul. They had a lot of questions about sex and marriage and all these things. So Paul is writing to them, now concerning the things of which you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. But then he says in 2 to 5, nevertheless, because of sexual immorality, let each man have his own wife, and let each woman have her own husband. Let the husband render to his wife the affection due to her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Do not deprive one another except with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer and come together again, so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Now you come back to the passage which we read in Proverbs chapter 5, verses 18 and 19 we read. Come to verse 20, see how it concludes. For why should you, my son, be enraptured by an immoral woman and be embraced in the arms of a seductress? Do you see the danger here? When the wife is very uncooperative in bed, the man goes to other women. Do you see that when a man has diabetic, the wife says, no, no, no sugar, no, no, no sweet, no, no, no rasgulla, no this thing. And the man, you know, he goes out, has nice ice cream and then all the sweets, cake, and then comes home like a good man. Isn't it? It says, you know, this many women are very uncooperative in bed, but the Bible strongly discourages this. Sex is not at all lust, within the marriage boundary. Come to Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 4. Marriage is honorable among all and the bed undefiled. But fornicators and adulterers, God will judge. See that marriage, within the marriage boundary, sex is not at all wrong. It's a good thing. Some people want to know, you know, can we use this word? Can we use that word when we have sex? Yes. Whatever pleases husband and wife, you are free to do. It's, there's nothing wrong about it. When you read that word in English, it is good. When you read that word in your own language, it's that word. So it's all. It's, there's nothing clean or unclean about anything. Some people say, you know, that sex is like a silent movie. Something you, it's a, women are trained to believe it is one of their duties. Like they have one to-do list. Wash dishes, wash clothes, finally sex. The day's program is over. It's not like that. God created sex not just for procreation, it is also for pleasure. God said you should have an abundant life. You know, the Song of Solomon is in the middle of the Bible, isn't it? I also used to feel, no, the sex is the central part of our life. See, in a home, when a man is satisfied sexually, he is very good in all other things. But when he has problems with his wife in the matter of sex, you know, he gets angry, he doesn't eat, he criticizes everything. Because it's a need. That is why it is in 1st chapter, Corinthians 1 Corinthians 7, we read, fulfill your marital duty. It's a duty for woman, of course, but she also should enjoy sex. So maybe it's not wrong to read some clean books about sex if you don't know about it. And one man, you know, he said he wanted prayer. Please pray for me that I will be delivered from lust for my wife. There is nothing called lust for wife or lust for husband. After marriage, there is no question of lust. No? But women, you know, they become very tired. They give lot of excuses. They'll say, it is too cold. My children are awake. The bed is creaking. This and that. So many. Or what they will do, they will lie in bed and think, what will I cook tomorrow? In our house, in India, you know, we'll be watching all the lizards going on. But here you don't have lizards. Maybe you'll be thinking, tomorrow I should clean up the room. Lot of cobwebs. That is not the way to have sex. Some women go and sit with a hairdresser for 2-3 hours to make one big hairdo. They can't relax half an hour with the husband. What for your hairdo? Husband doesn't want your hairdo. He wants you. For husband and wife, you know, the sex has a different meaning. For husband, sex means love. But for a wife, love means sitting and talking and having a nice time. Try to put both together. If you have difficulty, tell your husband, I am not well today. Can we have tomorrow? You should understand the sexual language also. Husband comes and says, so tomorrow? What tomorrow? Don't ask like that. You must be sensitive. If he brings flowers, if he brings some gift, you should relax and understand his mind. So that's how we should, that's a language, you know, which is not spoken, but must be understood by the woman. So be good. It's not, sex is not a sweet given to good children. The husband doesn't behave, no sex today. It's not like that. That is why the Bible says, you know, again we'll go to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Don't deprive one another. Do not deprive one another. Your body does not belong to you. Your husband has authority over your body. So, a wife should always relax, learn to relax. One brother wrote to me one letter, you know, my wife is like a wooden block in bed. Please write to her. Many women are like that. They don't enjoy sex. Simply, they will lie down. It's not like that. You know, your idea is to please the husband. have an open talk. Many men and women, no, the husbands and wife, they don't talk about sex. It's like split second, everything is, so it's not like you sit, talk. This is what I like, this I don't like, this is painful, this something, you know, you have to guide your husband. What is good and what is not good. Then you have to ask him, what gives you pleasure, what shall I do? Maybe I don't know. Because when you get married, you are novices. And you learn step by step, every day, every month, you increase, you learn. You have the freedom. So you learn to talk about it. And you dress well. Now, I'm married, now what? Hair is like this, hair is like this. I'm already married, where will you go? Not like that. Some women, you know, with the dirty dress and sweat streaming, husband comes home, she open the door, come. Then she'll back into the kitchen, not like that. And the husband is coming. Oh, you remember when you got married, what did you do? Oh, 4:30, 5:30 is not home. You clean up, you put some jasmine flowers, you put some spray, some scent, waiting. Then you open the door. Oh, you come, oh, why are you so late? Come, I'll make you coffee. Today? What do you do today? coffee is on the flask. Take your coffee. Headache? Put some on aspirin, you'll be alright. Because you are nurses, you know what to do. I used to do that, you know, but my mother-in-law will go and sit by my husband's side. She'll press his forehead. She'll put some balm. How are you, son? I used to feel so angry and jealous. But then I learned a lot of things. A man needs caressing, love, companionship. All these things you must be ready to do. So don't forget the olden days. Then trim up your body. Don't think, I'm married now, so. No. You have to be attractive to your husband. Trim up your body. Do exercise. Reduce your food. You know, the world is full of Potiphar's wives. So you also should be careful about yourself. You must look good. Put some powder, put some cream, or comb your hair. Okay? So we'll go to the other woman, next woman. Come to Proverbs chapter 6, reading from verses 24 to 29. To keep you from the evil woman, from the flattering tongue of a seductress, do not lust after her beauty in your heart, nor let her allure you with your eyelids. For by means of a harlot, a man is reduced to a crust of bread, and an adulteress will prey upon his precious life. Can a man take fire to his bosom and his clothes not be burned? Can one walk on hot coals and his feet not be seared? So is he who goes into his neighbor's wife. Whoever touches her shall not be innocent. Here we read about a neighbor's wife. She is not a harlot, but she is an unchaste woman. She is a wife, she is somebody's wife, but she is a loose woman, woman of loose morals. Here I want to divide this section into two and talk to you in two sections. First is, you are a neighbor's wife. You are somebody's neighbor's wife. You know, you are, nowadays women are working, you work in some office, the boss is there, your colleague's husband is there, and people are there. So when you go in the bus, you teach in a school, you come across so many men, even in Christian fellowships, you know, you come in close contact with other men, we go for ministry together. So you are somebody's neighbor's wife. You must always remember that. But sadly I find, you know, women are becoming loose and loose. I don't know. Sometimes I see these women patting on their pastor's shoulders, slapping men, going for ministry, laughing them, pinching. I don't like it. One day, you know, Paris, I was talking about these things. Then I thought, I'm talking stupid things in Paris. They all shake hands, they all touch men. And then, you know, the French lady came and told me, it's good you said, we tolerate it, but inside we burn. See, it's natural for the woman to burn when some other woman touches her husband. You should not flirt with men. You must know how to look at men. Train your eyes, because that is where adultery starts. first in the conversation. Men are human beings, even spiritual men. Spiritual men are also human beings. So you have to be extremely careful. Come to Proverbs, it's the same again, I'll read 24, 6:24. Okay, to keep you from the evil woman, from the flattering tongue of a seductress. See the flattery, you know, sometimes you see a brother and you say, brother, your t-shirt is so good, you look so good in this t-shirt. Then you forget about it, but he doesn't forget, you know. He may be thinking, okay, why did she say like that? She's so attractive. Maybe I'm so attractive to her. And then he goes and stands in front of the mirror. Yeah, I'm attractive. Okay? To be extremely careful about the conversation you have with other men. Talking to them. Have sexually tinged comments off. Don't even hint about sex or anything related to them. Be extremely careful. They can misunderstand. Sometimes the ulterior motive also, some women do that. Why am I warning you all this? Because I have seen this happen in the world. I have seen this happen in neighborhoods. I have seen this happen in churches. I have seen this happen in missions. I have seen this happen among missionary leaders, spiritual leaders. That is why I am trying and telling you again and again. Spiritual attraction is a very dangerous thing. If somebody is very spiritual, you get close and close and close. Then someday you say, brother, I have this problem. And he puts his arms on your shoulder and says, don't worry, sister, I'll pray for you. That's how it starts. Don't touch men. Don't go very close. You have to be extremely cautious. And then what happens? In 6:25, it goes to the heart. The conversation goes to the heart. Do not lust after her beauty in your heart, nor let her allure you with her eyelids. It goes deep into the heart. Then you start thinking. Then the eyes, it says, catching with the eyelids. Then 6:29, what does it say? Whoever touches him shall not be innocent. For the woman, whoever touches him shall not be innocent. Touching men with a wrong motive. That's why I said touches off. No touching men. You have to be extremely careful. Dress properly. Don't have provocative dresses. You see in women walking on the streets, you want to be one of them? No. Dress modestly. I want to tell you about a few things which are the snares of the devil. See, this temptation comes from the most trusted person, not from some stranger. A person whom you trust, a person whom you respect. That is why, you know, Bathsheba fell in sin. If some other man had called her, she wouldn't have gone. But David, he's the king, he's the spiritual person. So Bathsheba tumbled. So that's how it is. You have to be extremely careful. And then some people think, you know, mine is a very unusual case. It's not, this is God honored. You know, some women think, I am above all that, I can't commit all these sins. Don't trust yourself. And some people think God can forgive. He won't let me go to hell. Some ladies think it's too late to stop. I can't stop now, I've gone far. No. Anytime you can stop this wrong relationship. Sometime you have to cut it off. It is painful. It is painful. But you better do it before you go to hell. You cannot, some people say, I promised him. But let me tell you something. It's good to break a bad promise. The devil keeps on telling you, what have you achieved by struggling? You struggle, you are not out of it. But still, don't believe the lie of the devil. By struggling, you are doing something good. Keep on struggling. And a deliverance will certainly come. You have to cut off a bad relationship. I'll come to the second section of my talk. You have a neighbor's wife. In this world, our husbands go out to work. They move with a lot of ladies. And many women have lost their husbands to some other woman. See, sometimes the blame is the woman, sometimes not. Sometimes we are to be blamed, sometimes we are not to be blamed. Like, you know, you have to be careful, like some ladies, you know, they keep another woman in the house. Then they expect the man to, their husbands to be pure. It's very unwise. Like a man and woman are like cotton and fire. It's like carrying coals in your sari. It's definitely it will get burned. The Bible says you have to be harmless as the dove, but wise as the snake. Have you any time prayed, Lord, I want to be like a snake. Lord, please make me like a snake. No? See, that's where women fail. You have to pray, Lord, give me the wisdom of the snake. We always pray, Lord, I want to be harmless as the dove. But where is the other half of the prayer? You have to be wise as the snake. I remember, you know, one story which I had, one simple story. There was a sadhu and a snake came to that sadhu and in that town, that snake was a very vicious snake and it was biting the children and harming people. So the children came and complained, sadhu, this snake is doing like this. So the sadhu called the snake and said, why are you doing like that? You should not do like that. So they agreed and then went. Then again the snake came, sadhu, you told me not to harm these people. You know what these people are doing? They are pulling at my tail and they are throwing stones on me. And the sadhu said, I said you don't bite people, you don't harm people. I never said you should not hiss. You understand the point? You should not harm people, but you should know how to hiss. When another woman is trying to steal your husband, you should really pull yourself up to your tallest height and do something about it. You show that person that you have a backbone. One lady, you know, she was telling me, Akka, I don't know what to do, Akka. This lady comes 7 o'clock in the morning, sits with my husband. She wants counseling. My husband is also counseling. I'm not happy. I'm not comfortable. And he wants me to make coffee for her. And then talk to your husband. Tell him no more coffee. Tell that woman no more counseling. Oh, I can't do that. How can I do that? I'm so scared of my husband. If you're scared of your husband, then you're going to lose your husband. This is where women fail. When they notice something wrong is happening, they have to be bold. And you have to act with the wisdom of the serpent. So, I'm not telling you that you should suspect everyone. But I'm telling you, keep your eyes open. You need not trust other women. Even the most spiritual woman, there is no need that you should trust. Okay, be good, hold hands, very good. But have your eyes open. Be careful. All are human beings. All women are human beings. All of us can fall. All of us can be tempted. This jealousy, you know, some women, they go and cry and confess, Lord, I'm sorry, I suspected my husband. I'm so jealous. Don't do like that. That is foolishness. This is all natural. You will feel jealous. You will feel angry. You don't have to confess it to God. You see that you channelize it in the proper way. Your husband belongs to you and you have every right to protect your husband. Jealousy is very protective. You come to Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verses 6 and 7. Set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is as strong as death. Jealousy is as cruel as the grave. It flames or flames of fire, a most vehement flame. Many waters cannot quench love, nor can the floods drown it. If a man would give love for all the wealth of his earth, it would be utterly despised. See, there is a difference between love and jealousy. You don't protect your husband out of jealousy, but out of love. You want your family, you want your family to glorify God. And so that's how you have to be. Extremely, you have every right to stop that woman and you have every right to tell your husband no, you should not go to her house. So women must be really tough, you know, sometimes love must be tough. Come to Song of Solomon chapter 6 and verse 10. See how a woman should be. Song of Solomon verse 6 and chapter 6 and verse 10. Who is she who looks forth as the morning, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, awesome as an army with banners? Can you be like the moon and can you be like the sun? You have to be like the moon, you have to be two contrasting characters, no? Yes, a woman has to be like the moon, very gentle, smiling, loving, kind, pleasing. A husband who loves the moonlight, but clear as the sun. You know, in the moonlight details are not seen, but in the sunlight every detail can be seen. A woman must be very sharp. She must be very clear in her mind. That is why the Bible often speaks about Telindabuti, English la nama potrukom, sensible. Women have to be very sensible. The Bible often speaks about common sense for women. She has to be like the sun. And then it says, awesome as an army with banners. I like the old translation, King James version. It says, terrible as an army with banners. Have you heard this song? When she is bad, when she is good, she is very, very good. When she is bad, she is horrible. That is how a woman must be. When you are good, you must be very, very good. But you also must know how to be terrible as an army with banners. Only then you can save your family. So, be very careful in this matter also. Sometimes, you know, that obedience versus wisdom also comes. Husbands, I have to obey my husband. My husband says, you go to home to your mother's house. And you come after 1 week, a woman should do, why is he sitting me? I should not say no, I have to obey. Don't go out, pack your things and go. Okay, there are times when you don't have to obey. That also should be clear to you. You know, Abraham wanted Hagar to be there. You know that? Abraham was hurt when Sarah said Hagar must go. Did Sarah obey? She said, nothing doing. Hagar must go. She put her foot down and said, no, Hagar must go. And what did God say? You listen to what Sarah says. So that's how it is. And then again, lot of other women are there. But I think it's time to stop. You read from the book of Proverbs about the sent forth woman, how women should do ministry, and the contentious woman, and the clamorous woman, and the mother-in-law is there. So many women are there. Take it as a study and study the Bible as a woman. From the woman's aspect, you will learn a lot of things. Let's pray. You have come into the presence of God. You have seen inside your heart what kind of a mother you are. Dear women of God, God has given you a big responsibility of bringing up your children. That is the number one priority in your life. Don't neglect your children. You cannot take your degrees to God. You cannot take your salary to God and say, Lord, see what I have done. The Lord is not interested in all those things. God has given you something more precious than that. Can you take your children to God and say, Lord, you gave me these children, now I am giving them back to you. Like Hannah, who stayed at home to feed her child and then brought him and gave him to God. He became a mighty prophet. Give them the religious training. Give them, discipline them, love them. Let them go when the time comes. Be a wife who will stick to the husband. Never, never think of divorce. Our forefathers did not divorce. Why? Because they didn't think divorce was an option. That's the simple reason why they did not get divorced. Today we have an easy option for every problem, divorce. Don't take that easy step. Stick together through thick and thin. God will bless you for it.
children are the victims of divorce. Let not your child go through that terrible emotional torture. At least for your children's sake, stay together. A loving wife, cooperative in bed, satisfying the husband. You're a neighbor's wife, take care, don't flirt, don't destroy men, don't destroy spiritual men. Mighty men have fallen because of the carelessness of women. Take care. You have a neighbor's wife. Be wise as the serpent. And may the Lord help you and give you wisdom. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the precious time we could sit in your feet and learn so many things. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you will make us good mothers, good wives, good women who will bring honor to the home, honor to the church, and honor to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.